Welcome back. It's time to dive into the big and small updates of July. Last month was packed with incredible features and improvements. If you've missed any of them, don't worry, you're at the right place for all the highlights. First up, drag and drop widgets. This was one of my favorite features this year. I mean, you can build such nice UI experiences with it. FlutterFlow was one example, and in July, we made these widgets even better. So before, when you dragged an object from the draggable widget to the drag target, the object just stayed in place until the drag was completed. Not so great for games or Kanban board apps, right? But now we have added a new property called child when dragging, which lets you add a custom component in the place of the draggable widget while you're dragging it around. It gives you that neat illusion that the object is actually being dragged from one spot to another, making your UI interactions even more interesting and fun. Next, we have some updates on APIs. We've all been using regular REST APIs where we get a response when we ask for it. Pretty handy, right? But here's the catch. What happens when the API needs to send a very long response back? Take OpenAI or Gemini APIs, for example. What if you send a complex prompt that takes a long time to process? Yep, you guessed it right. We keep waiting and waiting. But not anymore. FlutterFlow now has the support for handling streaming APIs. Streaming APIs, unlike REST APIs, process data in chunks and sends these chunks to the app right away. This means your app starts receiving response almost immediately after sending the request. Adding a streaming API in FlutterFlow is similar to adding other REST APIs. However, parsing and extracting the data might be a little different. For example, with a streaming API, you can listen to these three different events and respond with actions accordingly. OnMessage is triggered every time a new data chunk is received. You can add actions here to update the UI or perform any necessary logic with the incoming data. OnError is triggered if there are any errors during the call. You can handle some error handling actions here to ensure users are aware. OnClose is triggered when the call is complete and all data chunks have now been received. Once you handle these cases and parse the data correctly, you will be able to handle any streaming APIs and display the data accordingly. I suggest you watch this detailed video on streaming APIs or read this guide on the documentation to learn more about streaming APIs and how to parse the data correctly. And here's a quick chat app demo with Gemini 1.5 Flash that you can play around with. You can find this template on the marketplace. Time for some debugging updates. If you've been enjoying Debug Panel on test mode, you'll be happy to hear this, because Debug Panel, still in beta, is now available on local run. When you run your app, you will find the Flutter DevTools button on the local run settings dialog. This will open the Debug Panel on another page, allowing you to search the variables or monitor the data flow as you navigate through the app. Need to turn it off for a session? Simply go to local run configuration menu and disable debug logging. Additionally, we also had some smaller updates for last month. We have a new property for text widgets, shadows. You can customize the shadow's color, the blur radius, or offsets for both X and Y axis. Plus, you can combine multiple shadows on a single text widget. Imagine adding subtle drop shadows for a 3D effect or combining different shadows for a unique layered look. Well, that's now possible in FlutterFlow. It's always helpful to add meaningful notes to your page or component so a new developer looking at your project has better context. So now, in the latest update, you can add descriptions when you're creating a page or a component. You can also add them later from the properties panel. Also in the generated code, these descriptions will be added as comments, so it's easier to understand and maintain the code later. And lastly, but incredibly useful, you can now update the minimum SDK version for Android and minimum iOS version from the app settings. This ensures your app is compatible with any external package that require a certain version, keeping your app up to date with necessary dependencies. And that's all the update for July. FlutterFlow and Flash are working super hard on some secret features for FFDC. I hope you've bought your ticket to New York or to the virtual conference this September because you are going to love the updates. For more details, go to ffdc.io.